Good evening and welcome to the Center for Jewish History. Tonight's program was generously brought to us by the cultural team of the Congregation Bet Simchat Torah, and I really would like to express our deepest gratitude for the dedication and the work that they put in this production. Particularly, I would like to thank Neil Hoffman, Rabbi Yele Cohen, and Rabbi Sharon Kleinbaum. This is the fourth of a very well-curated series of events celebrating the history and culture of Jewish communities from around the world and that CBS has produced through the years. Each one of these events brings to the New York public the history and culture and diversity of Jewish life. Our guests tonight are Uman Sershar and Tanya Eshagov. Uman Sershar is the Director of Publications at the Center for Iranian Jewish Oral History and is a member of the board at the Society for Iranian Studies. He received his PhD in Comparative Literature from Columbia University, where he is now a member of the University Seminar Series. He has co-edited three important volumes on the contemporary history of Iranian Jews. The lecture he's about to present is based on a very beautiful produced book, Esther Children, A Portrait of Iranian Jews. Tanya Eshakov is a pianist and a composer. She was born to an Iranian Jewish family that emigrated to the United States during the revolution. And her music combines memories of Persian traditional music and soundscapes from the city of New York. She has received her musical training at Queens College, and I understand she has studied in Siena, Italy. Tanya has performed at Carnegie Hall and Symphony Space, and she has also been the featured guest for the Ambassador of the Middle East at the United Nations. Her ensemble tonight includes Edward Smaldone on bass as musical director, Ali Bell and Sky Steele on violin, Chris Hoffman on cello, Danny Mellon and Swiss Chris on hand percussion and tombak. Now, the flow of the evening will include a short Q&A between the lecture and the concert. And afterward, you are welcome to join our guests for coffee and dessert and book signing and CD signing. For those of you here for the first time, I'd like to say a few words about the Center for Jewish History. The center is the home of four important archival collections documenting the life and culture of the Jewish diaspora from Central and Eastern Europe, from America and the Middle East. It is particularly relevant to tonight's event, the recently created archive of the American Sephardi Federation. The archive documents Sephardic life in America and Sephardic life from the many land of origin of the Sephardic people. I would like to take this opportunity to encourage those of you who have access to documents and materials that tell a Sephardic story to become involved with the center and join us in the important work to build an historical archive and make it relevant to contemporary life, which is what we do at the center. We have a continuous link between the reading room upstairs, our archives, and the auditorium, where a general audience enjoys what scholars and artists create and develop upstairs. I'm going to close this introduction with a warm thank you to the CJH team. Our program office and PR office did a tremendous job, and I really like to thank them. And I leave the stage to Ayala Cohen, who would like to say a few words. Thank you for being here tonight, and enjoy the evening.
On behalf of Congregation Beit Simchat Torah, I want to welcome all of you tonight and let you know how thrilled we are to be here in our first of what I hope of many collaborations with the Center for Jewish History. Why are we having this program, The Jews of Iran, tonight? Well, of course, at the end of this week, we will celebrate the holiday of Purim. The story, of course, happened in what is modern-day Iran. And what better way to celebrate this holiday than to look back to the rich cultural heritage from long ago and up until recent times of the Jewish community of Iran. We are really thrilled to be here tonight, as I said, with the Center for Jewish History, and to be in partnership with the American Sephardic Federation. This is most likely the first ever collaboration between a gay and lesbian synagogue and a national Sephardic organization, and it could not happen anywhere else but in this wonderful city of New York and in this wonderful organization. I want to offer my profound thanks to CBST's Education Committee, to Natalia Indrimi from the Center for Jewish History, to Neil Hoffman, the member of our Education Committee who put so much of himself into this program, and of course to Human Sharshar, who is simply the inspiration for this program. And it is truly a gift for all of us that we have someone in our midst who is a treasured member of the Iranian Jewish community, of the gay and lesbian Jewish community, and who has so much to teach us tonight.
Control tab. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Thank you very much for coming. It's such an honor for me to participate in this event. I found out 4 days ago that the event was sold out and hadn't really realized how popular the event would be. I would like to thank the Center for Jewish History, Congregation Beit Simchat Torah, and the Sephardic House for making this evening happen. Neil Hoffman was the kind friend who approached me about the event, and I'm extremely grateful to him. Thank you, Neil. And Natalia and George and Linda have bared with me through my craziness of making this event happen and my crazy calls, and I thank you very much for making it all happen. It's a beautiful evening. I have the virtually impossible task of giving you this 2,700-year story of the Jews of Iran in about 40 minutes tonight. So we're not going to see everything, but hopefully when the evening is over, you'll have a sense of who we are and where we came from and what we contributed to the culture and history of Iran. The history of Iranian Jews begins in 721 BCE with the first migration out of Jerusalem. The first presence of Iranian Jews is quoted in the Bible, and that's how we know that they were there around Hamadan, which is in northwestern Iran, at approximately 722 BCE. But the real story begins with the diaspora, when in approximately 586 BCE, Nebuchadnezzar came and took over Jerusalem and took thousands of slaves with him back to Babylon. And in 539 BCE, Cyrus the Great, Kurush Kabir, the first emperor of the Achaemenid Empire, conquered Babylon and freed the slaves and allowed them to go back to Israel, to Jerusalem, rebuilt the temple, and worship their gods. Because when they were in Babylon, as many of you know, they were no longer allowed to practice Judaism. The dark arrow here and the smaller arrows here show the second and third movement of Iranian Jews, and that's when they arrived in Iran. Among these people were the ancestors of Esther, Mordechai, Daniel, Ezra, Nehemiah, and many others that we'll talk about soon. This is the known as the Cyrus Cylinder. It's a clay cylinder that measures approximately 13 inches wide. It's written in Babylonian cuneiform. It currently lives at the British Museum. And it is in here that Cyrus the Great gives the Jews the right to go back home and build the second temple. This document, this cylinder, is known to many as the first declaration of human rights in history. It is an honor to Iranians that it was written by an Iranian monarch, and it is an honor to Iranian Jews that it mentions them in particular in liberating them from Babylon. Over here, we have a tombstone that was discovered in Isfahan's Jewish cemetery, known as Sarabat Hasher. What you see here is a tombstone that, written in Hebrew. It was discovered in 1946 by archaeologists, and it bears a date of approximately 500 BCE on it, which tells us that without any reasonable doubt, Jews had been living in Isfahan by this point for 2,500 years. Over here, you see a picture of a monument known as Esther Mordechai or Esther Khatun in Iran. It is located in Hamadan, and it is the tomb of Esther and Mordechai. It was renovated in 1973 by a Jewish-Iranian architect who contributed the article to the book. Among the many important things about the monument is the hole you see here. This door is the entrance to the mausoleum. And the hole you see here is considered by many as one of the earliest examples of lock in Iran. It's a hole that's approximately 12 to 13 inches in diameter, and the way it functions is you have to put your hand in it, reach down, and pull a lever that allows you to open it and push the stone slab open so you can enter the mausoleum. It is located in Hamadan, and one of the only remaining synagogues in Hamadan is still functioning in Esther Mordechai's tomb. This is the tomb of Esther. The original one burnt in a fire in the 18th century, and this is a replica of it. Right next to it, where you're standing, is the tomb of Mordechai. You're looking at Esther's tomb. This is the tomb of the prophet Daniel, located in Shush. And it is the second of important Jewish historical figures who is buried in Iran. From their arrival to Iran until approximately the arrival of Islam in 650 CE, Jews had, from what we know, a very comfortable life in Iran. They were allowed to participate in every aspect of society. They participated in government, in the military. They found their ways to the court. Esther was only one of these people. Mordechai was another one. Nehemiah was a cupbearer to one of the Achaemenid kings, which is an extremely, extremely important and delicate position. Because of his position, he was able to poison the king at any moment. So that gives you an indication of the trust that existed between the court and the Jews of Iran. They were often, they participated in every level of society. Some were tax collectors, others were in the military. And the situation continued until approximately 650 when Islam arrived in Iran. The document you have before you is a letter from a merchant. It was discovered in the early 19th century. It dates back to the 8th century CE. And the contents of it are not so important as the fact that the letter is written in Hebrew alphabet, but it's in Persian. This is the oldest existing document of Persian language currently known to historians. Once again, it is an honor to the Jews of Iran that the oldest surviving sample of Persian language is written by an Iranian Jew to his Iranian Jew partner in Hebrew, and it's currently living in one of the libraries in England, I believe. The situation of the Jews of Iran changed a little bit with the arrival of Islam, but the way it changed is that they just became treated like other non-Muslims. So there were limitations based on the fact that they were Jewish. They had to start paying the jizya, which was a poll tax that all non-Muslims had to pay. But for all intents and purposes, things were pretty tolerable. They still found their ways through government. one of the most important governors of the medieval ages, Rashid ad-Din Hamedani, was an Iranian Jew. He was born to Iranian Jewish parents. The story is that he converted to Islam in his teens, but he was eventually murdered for being a Jew and was not allowed to be buried in a Muslim cemetery. So he died as a Jew and pretty much lived as one. He was one of the wealthiest governors of Iran of his time. And his claim to fame is that he has written the most comprehensive history of the Middle East up to his time, and which is a document still considered one of the most valuable sources of history to any historian of the Middle East studying the medieval period. Things, however, start to change with the arrival of the Safavid dynasty in 1501. Shah Abbas takes the throne in 1501, and among the many different changes that occur in the socio-political fabric of Iran was that the Shiite creed of Islam was declared as the dominant creed of Islam throughout Iran. As a result, the Shiite clergy became extremely powerful, and many things changed in the social fabric of Iran. One of the things that changed, because of the desire for the Shiite clergy to convert anyone they could to the Shiite creed of Islam, they introduced the notion of najasat, religious impurity or religious pollution, according to which all non-Shiites were considered religiously impure. This impurity was a problematic thing because, as many of you know, Muslims pray five times a day, and they cannot go to prayer if they are considered impure. They have to go through a relatively extensive cleaning ritual before they go to prayer. So coming into contact with any non-Shiite was problematic for that reason and other reasons as well. And for reasons that aren't really clear and are still debated by scholars, the notion of najasat was most vehemently associated with Jews. As a result, the Shiite clergymen who were in power regularly put out decrees or fatwas that limited the lives of Iranian Jews in many, many ways. Jews were not allowed to leave their houses on rainy days because water was considered one of the most important and one of the most effective catalysts of or conductors of this religious impurity. So the fear was that if the rainwater splattered off of them and landed on the Muslim passerby, the Muslim would become ritually impure. They were not allowed to build houses with walls higher than their Muslim neighbors. They were not allowed to sell or buy property from Muslims. They were not allowed to sell or buy foodstuff from their Muslim compatriots. If they went into a food shop and touched something, they were forced to buy whatever it was that they touched at whatever price the merchant demanded because the food had now become inconsumable to the Muslim Shiite compatriots. They were dress codes and various other things were imposed upon them. The notion of the Jewish patch or Yahudiane or Yahudane was brought back, and they were all forced to sew patches on their clothes, an idea that was later picked up in the mid 20th century by the Third Reich. And life became extremely difficult. One of the major impacts that this difficulty had on the Jews of Iran was that they were forced to gather together in certain quarters and neighborhoods where they could live in the safety of their collective. These neighborhoods are known as the Mahalle by Jews or Mahalle-i Judha, the Jewish quarters, and many of them are still around. The photograph you have before you is a photograph of the Mahalle in Tehran, known as Sarechal. This photograph was taken in the late 18th century by an Armenian photographer who came to Iran and produced beautiful, beautiful photographs. This is one of them. Over here, you will notice a pit. The pit is the center of the neighborhood of the Jewish quarter Sarechal, and it gives the quarter its name. Sarechal literally means around the pit or by the pit. The reason it was called this is because the government did not provide sanitation to the Jewish quarter, so they were all forced to bring all of their refuse and dump it in the center of town. This caused tremendous problems because the Mahalleh in Tehran is at the lowest part of the city, so whenever it rained, all the rainwater would collect there, and you can imagine that it was not at all a comfortable place to live. Over here, you have a photograph of the Mahalleh, another Mahalleh in Tehran. Making this book had a lot of really magical moments for me. One of them was one night I came home about 10:30 from work, and I had received an extremely enthusiastic message from a person who is now a very dear friend, who went on my answering machine about how thrilled he was to have found the book, because in it he found the door to his father's house, and this was the street in which he played when he was a child, and it's the only remaining photograph he has of his childhood in Iran. Stories like that happened often for me in the making of this book and thereafter. Over here you have the entrance to Isfahan's Mahalleh. The Jewish quarter in Isfahan is known as Juibadeh. The gentleman standing here is Dr. Habib Levi. The Jews of Iran and Iranian historians are tremendously indebted to this gentleman. He has written, to date, the only comprehensive history of Iranian Jews in Persian. It is a three-volume series that is an indispensable source to anyone doing any kind of studies in Judeo-Persian studies. Dr. Habib Levi passed away in Los Angeles and, according to his own wishes, was buried in Israel in the late 80s. This is one of the streets in the Mahalleh in Shiraz, known as Ziretav. Ziretav means under the dome or under the roof, and you will notice at the top of the photograph the roof from which this neighborhood gets its name. In Shiraz, they had two mahalles actually, because at one point Reza Shah drove the main street through the center of Shiraz and divided the Jewish quarter into two. As a result, the Jews in this neighborhood referred to that neighborhood as the other quarter, and the ones in that neighborhood referred to the other one as the other quarter. So this is the other quarter in Shiraz. I just spoke to you about the dress code limitations that were placed on Jews. This is a photograph taken in the late 19th century. The photograph is taken in Dr. Daniele Sadiq's office in Hamadan. And what is exceptional about this photograph, you will notice women wearing white veils and women wearing black veils. One of the dress codes that was imposed on the Jews of Iran was that Jewish women were not allowed to leave their house wearing the white face veil. They were forced to wear black ones because this way the passersby would be able to recognize a Jew from a non-Jew and know to keep away. And in this photograph, you can recognize this woman here holding her child as Jewish. This one is Jewish. This one is Jewish. Over here, you will see a woman not wearing Islamic garb. She's most likely Christian or possibly Zoroastrian. And the reason is that of all the religious minorities in Iran, the Jews were the ones that conformed the most to the Islamic dress code. And that is probably one of the reasons why they were requested to wear the Jewish patch on their clothes, because otherwise it was impossible to distinguish them from their Muslim compatriots. I'm speaking a little fast because we have a long way to go, and I'd like to have some time for question and answers. The history of Iranian Jews is pretty much very dark and gloomy for the 400 years following the rise of the Safavid dynasty. It is riddled with episodes of forced conversion and pogroms that would happen occasionally. These forced conversions were often reasons for the clergy or the governor to extort money from the Jews in a certain town, because what would happen is they would go and they would basically raid the Jewish quarters, force everyone to convert to Islam, and then in a month, in 3 weeks, in 4 weeks, they would send the big rabbi to go beg for forgiveness. Please allow us to be Jews again. All right, I'll think about it. Bring me all the money you have. Done. So this kind of interaction happened regularly in the course of Jewish-Iranian history, with the exception of once in the early 19th century in Mashhad. Some of you have recently heard the name Mashhad. The train wreck that happened about 3 weeks ago was 70 kilometers southwest of Mashhad, And it is an exceptionally holy city in Iran. The most important Muslim shrine, or one of the most important ones, is located in Mashhad. And as a result, Mashhad is a place of pilgrimage for Iranian Shiites and Shiites throughout the world, in fact. The story of the Jews of Mashhad, some of you know about the Mashhadis in Great Neck, and you often ask me what's their story, and I'm about to tell you. On March 26, 1839, which coincides with Eid al-Qurban, the Feast of Sacrifice, which is a very, very important religious day for Shiites. It commemorates God's covenants with Abraham. And to honor that covenant and to remember it, recall it, Iranian Shiites have elaborate rituals of public sacrifice. Animals are sacrificed, their meat is given to the needy, and in a very not untypically Iranian way, the larger the animal, the greater the sacrifice. So sometimes these sacrifices are camels and big cows. It's the whole city gets involved, especially around that time. It was a major event. On this day of March 26th, a Jewish Iranian, the story isn't clear, but the story that is generally accepted is this, that a Jewish Iranian woman who was suffering from leprosy goes to the town doctor and asks him what she's supposed to do about her lesions. And he gives her what was then common medical advice, which is that she was to go home and sacrifice and kill a dog and soak her leprosy lesions in its warm blood. This ill-fated woman goes home, goes back to her house in the Jewish quarter, Eid Gah, in Mashhad, and proceeds to kill the dog and soak her hands in it. And the Muslim neighbor who was observing this from over the wall thinks that she was mocking the ritual of the Eid al-Qurban, or the Feast of Sacrifice. He runs to town, tells everyone that a Jew is mocking their ritual. It doesn't take long for the entire town to rise up and riot and descend upon the Jewish quarter. Within 24 hours before the end of the day that day, the entire Jewish community of Mashhad was converted to Islam. Those who did not convert were killed. And in order to secure the conversion, many of the clergymen in Mashhad married the young Jewish women who were not married yet to make sure that they would not return to their religion. And the tragedy of the Jews of Mashhad is that usually this situation is overturned. In the case of Mashhad, it never was. As a result, for the remaining 70 or 80 years, the Jews of Mashhad lived as crypto-Jews. They were Jews inside their home and lived as devout Muslims outside. They went to mosque and came home and prayed. They had the kashrut, the animals that were sacrificed according to Jewish law, in their backyards. And on their way home, they would buy meat at the Muslim butcher shops and give the meat away. They worked on Saturdays to make sure that everyone knew that they were not observing Shabbat. And life was very difficult for them. One of the ways that they came up with to be able to maintain their Jewish identity was that they figured if their children are able to intermarry, they will be able to outlast this situation. As a result, Mashhadis married very young, and often they were promised to each other at birth. Before I get there, as you see from this photograph here, these are all Jews, but there is nothing about their garb, their dress, their presence, or their appearance that gives you any indication. They look like they're Muslim compatriots. They often even usually selected Muslim names such as Muhammad or Abbas or Ali, and in order to conceal their Jewish identity. This is another photograph of a Mashhadi family. As you see, the turbans and the garments, everything is typically Persian, and there is no way to tell that there are Jews. The picture you have before you is a wedding ceremony. This is the bride, this is the groom. This was the only way they could secure their Jewish faith of their children. Because this kind of stuff happened in the Muslim community as well, it didn't really raise eyebrows. So if someone came to ask for the hand of one of their daughters, they would be able to tell them that she's either already married off or she's been promised to her cousin, excuse us, maybe next time, we would love to be family, but unfortunately we can't do it. This is a photograph of an engagement. This is the bride standing next to her father-in-law and her groom. Among the many fortunes I had in doing research for this book, and when they performed the weddings, in as you would expect of crypto Jews, they performed a Muslim ritual and a Jewish ritual. As a result, they had a qabale, which is an Islamic marriage contract, and the ketubah. And one of the wonderful fortunes I had in my research for this book was that I was able to find two matching pairs of marriage contracts. Over here, you have the Jewish ketubah, and over here is the Islamic qabale. They bear the same name of the bride and groom. Finding this pair would be tantamount to finding a ketubah that was written in Auschwitz and survived after the liberation. These, because it threatened their lives, they would hide the ketubahs, and the ketubahs were often destroyed. So most Mashhadis have their Islamic marriage contract, but the ketubah is very rare. And the second pair belongs to the son of the groom from the first pair. To my knowledge, there isn't a museum or a library in the world that has a matching pair. I was fortunate enough to find two for the book. This is a photograph of the groom after the wedding, many years after the wedding. And this is the photograph of his wife many years after this photograph. Life for the Jews of Iran was additionally complicated because of the limitations that were placed on them because of this notion of najasat. There was very little they could do to make money. They weren't allowed to sell food. They weren't allowed to buy or sell property. As a result, they engaged in the trait of non-edibles. Over here we have a beautiful painting by Kamal al-Mulk, who is the father of realist painting in Iran. He painted in the late 18th, early 20th century. And the photograph is called The Jewish Peddler. Over here what you see is the two Jewish peddlers trying to sell a piece of textile to a Muslim Iranian. And of note, and we can rely on this because we know of Kamal al-Mulk's insistence on realism in his paintings, is that the Jews are not wearing socks. They're not wearing socks not because they couldn't afford it, but because they were not allowed to by decree. You also notice the Jews have their outer garments closed with a string or a rope, and this is also, as well as an indication of their poverty, it is also an indication of the decrees. Jews were not allowed to wear sashes around their waist, nor were they allowed to wear hats such as this one. So it's an important document in that it shows that up until the end of the 19th century, the decrees that came into being at the beginning of the 15th were still in place and very much adhered to. Over here you have a photograph of a Jewish carpet dealer, one of the trades that they were allowed to do. And this here is the Bakhshi family. Among the other traits available to the Jews of Iran was music. When the Shiite came to power and the Shiite creed became the dominant form of Islam, one of the things that was outlawed in Iran was all non-liturgical music. As a result, Jews and other non-Shiites were the only ones who were allowed to perform the traditional musics of Iran. It is one of the honors of Iranian Jews that they were in a position, in spite of the oppressive environment in which they lived, that they were able to maintain that and keep alive the traditional music of Iran, to eventually hand it back down to their Muslim compatriots and keep that ancient tradition alive. Tanya will be giving us some of the pieces of this traditional music later. And families often went into music business because they were able to go to parties and perform and collect money, so it was a means of income for them. Over here, you have a photograph of Musa Khanekashi, one of the masters of traditional Persian music. He played the kamanche and the ney as well as the tar in the court of Zelal Sultan, the brother of Nasir al-Din Shah, who was the governor of Isfahan. And next to him is a photograph of Bala Khan. Bala Khan is the father of Murtaza Khan and Davud, one of the big masters of Persian music in Iran. Bala Khan was also a court dargir. He played a percussion instrument. And over here you have a photograph of Murtaza Khan and Davud. To really reenact the relationship of Jews to traditional Persian music, in the early 1970s, Murtaza Khan and Davud went to the studios and recorded the first and to date only existing repertoire, complete repertoire of traditional Persian music. It represents over 110 hours of taped recorded music, and it is to date the only complete repertoire of that music existing. One copy is in the Jerusalem University, and another copy is still back in Iran at the, I think it's at the television and radio studio archives. Among the other professions that Jews were allowed to do in the 19th century was medicine. You have a photograph before you of Nur Mahmud, one of the famous doctors of the late 19th century in Iran, photograph again taken by Sivurgin. Around him are his medical students, and this is his wife. You have a beautiful view of a typical Iranian home. She's in the Andaruni. Strange men were not, men who were not family were not allowed in that room. And he's holding his class, and these are his students around him. As a result of the tremendous social pressures that plagued the Jewish community in Iran, many started to convert to Baha'ism, Islam, and Christianity in the mid to late 18th century. The photograph you have before you in the center is Haji Lalizar. He's a very, very famous, one of the famous patriarchs in Hamadan. Many of the Hamadani families today are descendants of this gentleman who was a jeweler in the court of one of the Qajar princes. And he is surrounded by his sons and grandsons. What is exceptional about this photograph is that within the same family, you have Jews, Muslims, Baha'is, and Christians who are living together, and this was not an uncommon sight to see because people hoped to escape some of the pressures by converting. The fate of Iranian Jews started to change for the best in the late 19th century when the Alliance Israélite Universelle came to Iran and after 25 years of struggle with the government, opened their first school. The Alliance Israélite is a French institution that has a very specific agenda. It started in the early 18th century, and their idea was to go to all non-industrialized countries, especially in the Middle East, that had significant Jewish communities, and build schools there. The idea was that these countries would eventually have no choice but to join the industrialization revolution, and that if the Alliance Israélite had gone there and educated the Jewish community, it will provide the country with an army of people who would be able to participate in the industrialization campaign and no longer, because of their education, no longer be considered second-class citizens. This proved to be true over and over again in every country where the Alliance went, but nowhere more than Iran. In 1898, the Alliance Israélite opened its first school in Hamadan, and this photograph was taken on the day that the Jews of Hamadan received the decree to open the school. This is the photograph of the 16th anniversary of the Alliance Israélite in Isfahan. As you can see from all the bells and whistles, it was not an event to be taken lightly. The Jews loved the Alliance. It liberated them. It educated them. It also provided an environment where, because the level of education was so high, Muslim Iranians also started to send their children there. So Iranian Jews and Muslims started to close friendships that early on in their lives that went on for the remainder of their lives, and this eventually becomes reflected in the generation of my parents and especially of mine, where religious differences had virtually disappeared among the educated class of the society. After the Alliance arrived, and there was a lot of commotion at the turn of the century in Iran, namely the constitutional revolution that happened, that took place in 1906. One of the thoughts of the constitutional revolution was that they were going to abolish the second class citizenships of non-Shiites, with the exception of Baha'is. Article 8 of Iran's constitution finally achieved to do that. But as you can imagine, there was a lot of commotion in allowing for that kind of liberty to happen, and people did not like it. Anti-revolutionaries and anti-constitutionalists would routinely pillage Jewish quarters as a sign of their demonstration against the Constitution and their desire for Article 8 not to go through. Fortunately, they did not succeed. The photograph you have before you is a picture of an Elijah chair, an important part of the Brit Milah ritual. It was taken out of a shul in Shiraz by the Shirazi Jews because they anticipated a program, and in fact they were right. 2 days after the chair was taken out, the synagogue was burned, all the Torahs were destroyed, and this chair and its twin chair are the only surviving pieces of furniture from that synagogue. Among the other magical things that happened was I had to go to the Alliance Israélite in Paris to do research, and I came upon this photograph. On the back was a small scribble that said Kerman Shah, 1909. There were no descriptions for the picture. I didn't know what to do with it. I brought it back, scanned it, figured I'd be able to use it. I came home and went through Habib Levy's three-volume history, looked in the index and looked at Kerman Shah, and realized that on March 31st, 1908, there was a pogrom in Kermanshah. What had happened is that one of the established Jews in the community who had hired a housekeeper who was a Muslim, the person who had hired the Muslim housekeeper was a recent convert, a Jadidi, and the guy he had hired happened to die in his house of a heart attack. Well, rumors started that the Jadidi, the new convert, who was still in reality a Jew, had killed the man to use his blood in the matzah for the Passover. As a result, the community rioted. They descended upon the Jewish quarter, and they looted all of the houses. The photograph you have before you was taken by the Alliance Israélite, and the day after the looting, these are all the Jews of Kermanshah who had come to the courtyard of the Alliance Israélite to be able to recoup some of their furniture. The situation was so dire that the French government had sent 5,000 francs of 1909 money to Iran to try to compensate for some of the damages that had occurred. With the Constitutional Revolution, things actually did start to change for the better. Jews started to leave the mahalle, they started to get assimilated into the neighborhoods, and they started to be able to sell property to non-Muslims, buy from them, open stores outside of the mahalle, and be able to engage in all sorts of commerce, and start to live openly as Jews. The photograph you have before you is of the Balfour Declaration, a celebration of the Balfour Declaration taken in 1918 in the Alliance School in Hamadan. And of exceptional of noteworthiness in this photograph is the Magen David, the Jewish stars that you see on the lapel of some of the men in the photograph. This Jewish star is not to be mistaken with the one that Western Jews, Ashkenazi Jews, and Sephardic Jews of Europe were forced to wear by the Third Reich. The Jews of Iran wore this star with pride. It was the symbol of the Alliance Israélite. And the Alliance, after coming to Iran, used its tremendous influence to convince the government to abolish the Jewish patch and allow the Iranian Jews to wear the Alliance Israélite insignia on their collar, which they wore with pride. After the Constitution, Jews were once again allowed to join the army. And this is the earliest photograph I have found of an Iranian Jew in the Qajar army uniform. It was taken in 1925 Hakim family in Tehran. As you can see, this photograph was taken also in the other photograph was 1919. This is 1925. As you can see, if you compare this in your memory with the photograph you saw of the Mahalleh in Tehran, the life of Iranian Jews had tremendously changed in approximately 27 years as a result of the constitutional revolution and the education they were receiving. They started to leave the Mahalleh, they started to wear Western clothes, they were allowed to make money, they were allowed to participate in all levels of society, and so they did. Over here you have a photograph of Dr. Badiul Hukama, taken in Hamadan. The photograph is exceptionally noteworthy because the doctor is riding a white horse. The decrees that I told you about, one of them was the Jews were not allowed to ride white horses or white donkeys on the street. If they held an exceptionally important position, such as doctors, they were allowed to, they were made exceptions and they could do it. So this photograph documents one of those exceptions. Once again, as time went on in the 1920s and 1930s, life started to become better. They started to travel. You can see they're dressed, they're wearing Western clothes, they're cleaned up, and they're participating in all levels of society, including sports. The photograph you have before you is a photograph of the extremely threatening and ominous soccer team of Tehran, taken in... Where was this photograph taken? Oh, yes, in 1936. What is remarkable about this photograph is that it shows in their very early youth some of the leaders of the Jewish community. The gentleman you see here is Davud El-Ghanayan, a name familiar to all Iranian Jews and some New Yorkers. You all know the El-Ghanayan family from the Rockrose Corporation. The Rockrose Corporation, which is one of the major real estate companies in Manhattan, is owned by the nephews of Davud El-Ghanayan. Davud El-Ghanayan and his brothers went on to become, to own some of the most important conglomerates of business in Iran in the second half of the 20th century. Plastics, aluminum, tile manufacturing, imports were all done under their command and their company, Plasco. Haj Habib, Davud's younger brother, was the first private citizen to be executed by the Revolutionary Court in 1978. It was considered a big sign to all Iranians, to the wealthy Iranian Jews, that it was not going to be a comfortable place for them to live. Accused of Zionism and participation with the court, Haj Habib was executed soon after the revolution. The young boy you see here wearing the hat is Lotfullah Hay. Lotfullah Hay became the representative to the Jews in the Majlis, in the parliament in Iran, in 1966, and he remained a representative for two consecutive terms. And in 1967, when the Congress got together, selected 13 Majlis members to amend the Constitution, Lotfullah Hay was one of the participants of that event in 1967. In 1928, shortly after taking over, Reza Shah, the Shah's father, Reza Shah Pahlavi, took over the throne in Iran in 1925. He was an arch-nationalist and wanted to revolutionize Iran and westernize Iran, and he hated a lot of the backward ways about Iran. One of the first things that he changed was the dress code. In 1928, he insisted that all men start wearing European clothes, and that they had to wear the kepi, a hat known to Iranians as kola pahlavi, the pahlavi hat, and give up their traditional Iranian clothes. As you can see from this photograph, the outfits were somewhat new to the to Iranians. They didn't really know how to dress. The little boy here, his hat is too big. He's still wearing the giveh, the traditional Iranian shoe, but changes were starting to happen. In 1935, along the same line of changes, Reza Shah decreed that women are no longer allowed to wear the Islamic garb and that they all had to unveil. It's known as the official unveiling or kashf hijab in Iran. Women found it extremely uncomfortable to all of a sudden overnight start walking down the street without their veil and their scarves. So some took to wearing hats, and other older ones generally found more modern ways to substitute their veils. By this point, Iranians were participating in many levels of society. In spite of Reza Shah's sympathies with the Nazi Germany, his nationalism was a much bigger drive in him, and the Iranians who were Western educated were invited to participate in the Westernization and industrialization of Iran. The photograph you have before you is of Monsieur Abraham Rubin. Soon after the kashf-e hijab, Mr. Rubin, who was the hairdresser to the court of Reza Shah, realized that he had a tremendous opportunity before him, that women will now need to have their hair done. So he went and opened the first hair salon in Tehran. And to my knowledge, the hair salon was still open until right up to the revolution functioning. This is a site familiar to many Iranians. This is the Kohan Antique and Persian Rug Store, and it shows once again the Jews leaving the mahalleh, participating in the economy. This is a very, very, very far, far place from the photograph you saw in the mahalleh. As a result of the liberties that were allowed to them, Jews started to participate in other aspects of society, including the arts and the universities. The photograph you have before you here is of Moshfeqa Hamedani. Let me take a quick step back. In 1941, Reza Shah was overthrown by the Allies, and his son Mohammad Reza Shah was put to rule in his place. The Shah had many sympathies with the Jews of Iran, and his taking the throne marks the beginning of what Habib Alevi refers to as the golden age of Iranian Jewry. Starting with the arrival of Mohammad Reza Shah, Jews participated, really started to take over. Alcohol distillery, pharmaceuticals, banking, insurance, tile manufacturing, plastics, shipping, import, export, agriculture were all segments of society that were either directed under Jewish leadership or owned by them directly. Moshfeqa Hamedani was the first editor-in-chief of Kehan magazine, of Kehan newspaper, which is the equivalent to the New York Times in Iran, and also a celebrated translator of Dostoevsky. All of the people who read Dostoevsky in Persian in Iran are indebted to this gentleman. This is a photograph of Soleiman Haim. He wrote what is to date the most popular bilingual dictionaries of Persian French, Persian English, and Persian Hebrew. Everyone in Iran after Soleiman Haim who learned English or French in Iran is indebted to this man because he gave them the most important tool they needed in their education. The gentleman here, Manoucher Bibian, owned the single largest recording studio in Iran. Many of the pop artists in Iran who are known to all Iranians today were discovered by this man and recorded their albums in his studios. Jeanette Kohansedr, an athlete who broke the 100-meter race record three times in her life before dying of a tragic accident on her way a month before going to the Olympics, also an Iranian Jew. Her death was a tremendous blow to sports in Iran and was mourned by everyone throughout the country. The gentleman you see before you, many of you will remember the 25th centennial of monarchy in Iran. It was celebrated in 1971 in Shiraz. Heads of state from all over the place were invited by the Shah because Iran had finally been industrialized and he wanted to show it off. And he threw a huge, huge gala in Persepolis. in the middle of the desert, and the place needed to be irrigated and electricity needed to be brought. The gentleman you see before you is the Chief Planning Commissioner for Electrical Urban Development in Iran, and it is under his leadership that the entire event of the electrical and hands-on part of that event took place. His wife got a free backstage pass to all of the events, a journalist. As a result, her coverage of the event won her the Journalism Prize of the Year. She went on to become one of the leading women figures in Iranian media and journalism. And her latest book, the biography of one of the important historical figures in Iran, has become the most widely published book in modern history in Iran. Their two sons, one of them is currently a cancer researcher, an organic chemist working in San Diego. And the other one has written an interesting little book called Esther's Children, which you should all purchase on your way home. This is a photograph of members of Iran's Royal Academy. These are all extremely distinguished scholars, researchers, and university professors standing around Queen Farah Pahlavi. The Iraj Lalezadi is a world-renowned pharmacologist and chemist. He has written over 150 journals and book entries, and up until a couple of years ago, his two books on organic chemistry were mandatory reading for any student studying organic chemistry in Iran. His claim to fame is the discovery of an extremely potent poppy in the deserts of Iran that the American government wanted to buy the patent for because of the potent qualities of morphine, quantities of morphine available in it. And the other gentleman, also an Iranian Jew, standing right behind the queen, is Dr. Shemuel Rahbar. He is a renowned immunologist. I know that there are many doctors in our audience tonight. Those of you who are familiar with the hemoglobin A1C, which is the worldwide standard for the testing of diabetic patients, are indebted to this gentleman. The hemoglobin was discovered by Dr. Shemuel Rahbar at Tehran University. He's discovered many other hemoglobins, all of them named after Iranian rulers and kings. I know we're running out of time. I will be done in about 4 minutes. This bill has a fascinating story. It was published in 1974. It is a 200 rial note, and probably the most famous note in Iran's banking history. The day that it came out, rumors spread rampantly throughout Iran that the bill was published by Jews in Israel as a means to undermine Iran's booming economy. Their evidence was the six-corner star that's printed on the back of the bill. The fact is that the six-corner star is an ancient motif to all religions and present amply in many, many mosques throughout Iran. But the rumor that started was, in essence, one of the ways to break down the Shah and to spread rumors against him. He was an arch-Zionist and very close to the Jewish community. And those who did not like him in power often accused him of Zionism and collaboration with the Jews as a way of showing his lack of commitment to Iran and to the good of Iran, and really to call him a traitor. The rumor went so rampant. Oh, and this also happened, by the way, soon after the oil embargo, which many of you remember, when the Shah broke rank with all Arab countries and decided to sell oil to Iran. All Iranians got rich, and people saw it as yet another way that the Shah propagated his Zionist agenda and were very angry. The bill was released on a Thursday morning at 9 a.m. Rumors went rampant by noon. Everybody was talking about it. 10 million notes were printed. 1 million were distributed to the banks. By 3 o'clock Thursday afternoon, every remaining bill in the banks were collected. taken back to the coffers and burnt the next morning. As a result of the rumors, many Jews ran to the bank and started to collect the bills. And within a week, the bill was trading hands at over 5 or 6 times its face value. I still remember the day that my father came home that afternoon holding a stack, a bound stack of serial numbers, which was one of the prized possessions he took out of Iran when we left at the end of the revolution. The revolution, as you all know, happened in 1978. The Jewish community was extremely frightened for many reasons, one of them being the trouble and the execution of Haj Habib, and they decided that the best way to protect themselves was to revert back to Esther's legacy and join again with the Islamic Revolution and proclaim their solidarity with the people of Iran, which is what that banner says. So they took to the streets and participated in the revolution. Most of them left, many stayed behind. This is a photograph of Iran's chief rabbi, Hacham Yedidia. Many of the Iranians present here today were married by this man. This is his son, Rab David, who has now taken over his father's position in Los Angeles, leading the Jewish community in the revolution. This photograph was taken on the second anniversary of the revolution in Iran in the Abi Shami synagogue, which is the big shul in Iran. And this is Ayatollah Pasandideh, Ayatollah Khomeini's brother, sitting in shul with the Jews of Iran celebrating the second birthday of the revolution in Iran. And this, our last photograph, is a photograph of a collective bat mitzvah in Iran. You will notice all the girls are wearing Islamic garb, and the photographs of all the heads of state and standing under the new flag of the Islamic Republic. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. We started a little late. I talked a little too much, like I'm prone to do. I don't know if we have time for question and answers. If we do, somebody give me a signal. If we don't, yes, please.
We know from recent events that the basis for anti-Semitism within the Christian community comes from the crucifixion. What is the basis for anti-Semitism in Islam? What is it founded upon philosophically or religiously?
If you spoke Persian, I would tell you a common Iranian proverb that you're asking me questions that are postgraduate questions. I don't know if I can answer them. It's a complicated question, and I'm probably not the right person to answer it. It's a very, very difficult question to answer. I think one of the roots in Iran is what I tried to stress over the course of the talk, which was the shift to the Shiite creed of Islam in Iran. And I would like to believe that this shift created a rift, not just between Muslim and Jew, but between Shiite and all others. So in Iran in particular, my theory is, and my sense is, that what drove a tremendous degree of the anti-Semitism was in part the propaganda that the Shiite clergy had to convert people to Shiism. And because of the close relationship that the Jews have with the roots, and they didn't convert easily. Those who did often reconverted back to Judaism. It was a power struggle, really. But the question is a very complicated one, and this is not a complete answer. So I urge you to pursue answers yourself. Yes, please. I'm sorry, what was the trigger for them to go back to practice their religion? Well, there was no trigger. The trigger, there really was no trigger. It was basically a decision not to give up their Judaism. I'm sorry. That's a very good question. What freed them was time. The decree has still not been officially overturned. But what freed them was time and change in politics. But one of the impacts, this unfortunate event in the history of Mashhadi Jews had many impacts. I will talk about two of them. One of them is that, as you saw, they tended to marry within family in order to keep their Judaism. As a result, unfortunately, by our time, there are a number of genetic medical problems that exist in the Mashhadi community because they were passed down from family to family. The other, in my opinion, more tragic, was that when the Alliance Israelite came to Iran, they went to the heads of the Mashhadi community, the Jewish community, they sought them out, and asked them if it was okay to open a school there, and they strictly forbid it, because they did not want to be outed. And as a result, the Mashhadi community in Iran, up until well into the solid middle of the 20th century, remained, generally speaking, differently educated than the rest of Iranian Jews. So that really could be felt for years in their community. It was I think you call it a shanda in Yiddish. Yes. Yes, in the back. you're testing the bounds of my historical knowledge. There is at least one professor of history present among us today, and I'm ashamed to answer your question in his presence. I can't answer your second question. I don't know. The first question, I will try to give you a short answer, even though it's out of the topic of the book. It's a very complicated question. The issue of homoeroticism in Persian poetry is one that has been strongly fought and denied by many contemporary scholars in Iran. And it is unfortunately an irresolvable enigma. And the most important reason for that is there is no gender in Persian. So when a beloved writes poetry to his lover, it is impossible for you to stand there and state for sure that this is a man writing a love poetry to another man. There are ways to distinguish it. If he's talking about his peach fuzz, if he's talking about, you know, there are specific words that are described, that are used to describe men's hair as opposed to women's hair, but it's a complicated issue. So, you know, the Islamic Republic denies it. A wonderful book by the name of Shahid Bazi, that Adabiyat-e-Farsi, Homosexuality in Persian Literature, was recently published in Iran, and they banned it. So it's a big problem and not one that's easily resolved under the Islamic Republic. Yes. Yes. Knowing the level of dedication The first question was, given the level of anti-Semitism and hostility that the Jews experienced in Iran, why is it that they are so closely tied to the Iranian culture, and why is it that they so vehemently celebrate Iranian traditions and rituals to this day, even in exile? It's a question that people often ask me, and my answer is, for me, I can only talk to you personally, and which is, it's a love we have for the land. And we've been there for 2,700 years, which is longer than many things on this planet have been happening for. And it is a debt, an emotional debt, that I feel to one of the founders of that land for liberating our foreparents. And it is a love that I have for the language. To this day, I have a dog and she speaks Persian. I walk down the street and I'm speaking Persian to her, and people are like, well, your dog speaks Persian? I'm like, well, she also speaks English, but yes. So it's a fascinating question. And you know, there are many other reasons for it. For example, Iranians, the Jewish dialects of Iran, which we didn't talk about, all major towns in Iran have their own dialect. It's not like Yiddish in Europe. My father's family is from Isfahan, my mom's family is from Shiraz. My father's parents could be talking bad about my mother's parents to their face with a smile on their face, and they wouldn't understand a word of what they're saying. Linguists have proven that all of these languages are in fact closer to ancient Persian languages than the Persian you and I speak with each other today. So I don't know. It's an oppression, maybe because they were there before Islam. The invasion was experienced to them by, as others, as something that took liberties away from them. So it developed more emotional ties to the past. So they decided to keep it. I'm not sure, but it is a reality. To this day, in exile, the largest publishers of Iranian books and the largest sellers of Iranian books are Jews. Many of the very first Jewish of Iranian organizations that were established in Los Angeles were established by Jews. So it's a love that, you know, is in many of our hearts. The answer to your second question is just be curious. Sit your grandparents down and ask them questions, and use a tape recorder. Go through your family albums, you know, 500 photographs in Esther's children, and close to 450 of them came out of people's family albums that they brought to us one day and said, you know, we brought these albums from Iran, we didn't really think they meant anything, do you think this photograph is worth something? And it turns out that it documents very important aspects of our history. So go through your family albums. Sit your elders down and ask them questions. Ask them what it was like. Yes? Yes, there was approximately 80,000 Jews in Iran before the revolution, and there's currently somewhere between 25 and 30,000 remaining. Their situation, honestly, is no better or worse than that of other Iranians. They have a few limitations placed on them. An entire Jewish nuclear family cannot leave Iran at the same time. But there are other people who are not allowed to leave the country either. The answer to your question is, for the most part, it's the same as everybody else's. They're living under oppression. The party line for the government is that because of Islamic law, Iran's government has, at least in theory, a tremendous amount of respect for the Jews and liberty, because the Quran gives it to us. We are the first of the Abrahamic people, and as such are to be held in high esteem by Muslims. So the Islamic Republic of Iran has found a very interesting caveat. If they find a Jew and they don't like him, they simply accuse him of Zionism, and then they execute him. The honest truth is that it's really no worse than that of everyone living under that oppressive regime. I think we have time for one more question. Yes?
Why was Baha'i excluded from the
It's a fascinating question. The reason is that the clergy insisted on having a huge hand in the Constitution. Without the Shiite clergy, the constitutional revolution would likely not have happened. It's debatable, it's complicated, but they had a huge hand in it. According to Islam, the Baha'is are heathens. Islam, like all other Abrahamic religions, sees as legitimate the Abrahamic religions that came before it. So to them and to the word of the Quran, Baha'u'llah's word of being the last prophet of God is not acceptable. And therefore, they were not going to be given rights as a religious minority in Iran. And they are, of all of the minorities in Iran, they are the ones still currently most under the gun. They're persecuted.
Why would they be treated differently than the Zoroastrians?
Because the Zoroastrians are not an Abrahamic religion. So they're not considered a threat by Islam. You can convert to Zoroastrianism, but Muslims and Iran, non-Zoroastrian Iranians see Zoroastrianism more as a ritual and rite-based practice rather than a religion. So conversion to Zoroastrianism doesn't haunt Iranians like, you know, conversion from Judaism to Islam and back and forth. Thank you very much.
Thank you. 9/11, Trio.
She can talk about it. There's no tribute.